Is it true or not true that we sapiens are different? And if true, what do we have that is different from all other creatures on the planet? The characteristics that define the uniqueness and superiority of humans has been identified from time to time in their bipedal gait, large brains, ability to build tools, etc. But other animals are also capable of building and manipulating tools, albeit not with the same level of skill. Other animals have big brains and rich social lives, or, like certain primates, exhibit perfect upright stature when needed. Still, others are stronger or more aggressive or faster than we are, or they have better eyesight, a much more developed sense of smell, and so on. But that is not why they dominated the world of nature as we do. Where then does our extraordinary power come from, and at what point in our evolution did it materialize? There are not a few evolutionary traits that some researchers believe may have favored our species, handing it the scepter of the strongest. For example, there's the well-known thing of the opposable thumbs, which allowed us to manipulate with refined precision the construction of tools and especially weapons. And how can one underestimate the achievement of the upright position, which gave us the ability to use our upper limbs for functions far more important than walking? Another crucial point that came as a result of the transformation from gatherer to hunter was that of being able to obtain the noble proteins of meat, which were essential for the growth of the brain. The activity of hunting then necessitated increasingly developed cognitive processes and thus an increasingly complex brain. The verbal communication needed among hunters to coordinate their actions must then have fostered the refinement of the guttural sounds we were able to make and the emergence of the earliest forms of language. The discovery of fire then made food much more assimilable. It also allowed parasites and pathogens that carried serious infections to be destroyed by cooking, thus lowering the mortality rate. Fire also allowed predators to be driven away, and this meant more security, more peace of mind, and more time to devote to social relations. But can any of these characteristics alone transform a hominid into a human being? Difficult, if not impossible, to answer. Each of these evolutionary traits matured at a different stage of human natural history, and each contributed to the outcome. But some are not satisfied with this answer, and what one would like to get at is whether there was a specific reason or a specific time when the hominid became man. As if there has to be a fundamental turning point in the evolutionary path that must have inevitably led us to where we are. Remember the famous scene from 2001, A Space Odyssey? In the first part of the film, Dawn of Man, the story takes place on the African plains, and the protagonists are indolent hominids now on the brink of extinction. Then there will be contact with a mysterious and disturbing black monolith, which apparently will manage to ignite in the minds of the apes the spark that will enable them to conceive the use of improvised weapons to bring down animals and enemies. Here, in the imagination of many, there must be a topical moment like this, a moment in the real world that could not have existed. And at this point, the question changes and becomes, why did all these evolutionary fortunes happen to us? Is there any reason that can explain why the spark of intelligence was ignited only for us? Why not, for example, for the erectus or the Neanderthal? The answer in this case is as simple as it is brutal. It is not true that the spark ignited only for us. The fact is that sapiens eliminated any other species that could compete with them in the struggle for survival. 50,000 years ago, the Earth was not populated by a single human species, but by at least six different other representatives of the genus Homo. When the sapiens still stood around in a remote corner of Africa, there were Neanderthals in Europe and Western Asia, while the easternmost regions of Asia were populated by Homo erectus. On the island of Java, Indonesia, lived Homo soluiensis, who had acclimated to life in the tropics. On another Indonesian island, the small island of Flores, there thrived a species known as Homo floresiensis, whose individuals reached the height of no more than 1 meter and weighed 25 kilograms, yet capable of producing stone tools and even taking down elephants. Then, in 2010, another lost sibling was recovered in the Denisova cave in Siberia, when the remains of an individual belonging to a hitherto unknown human species, which took the name Homo Denisova, were discovered. And while these humans evolved in Europe and Asia, evolution in East Africa had not stopped. The cradle of humankind continued to nurture numerous new species, such as Homo rudolfensis, Homo ergaster, and finally, our species, which we have unassumingly called Homo sapiens, the intelligent man, the man who knows. Members of some of these species were large-bodied, others were dwarves. Some were tremendous hunters, others quiet gatherers of plants. Some lived on an island, remaining there, while many others migrated across continents, but all belonged to the genus Homo. They were all human beings, and they all had attained the same degree of intelligence as we have. This shows that possessing all those characteristics we were talking about earlier, bipedalism, opposable thumbs, use of fire, etc., inevitably leads to the development of intelligence, self-awareness, and imagination. None by itself is sufficient, but it is probably the combination of things that produces the spark. However, when sapiens spread across the planet, the other species disappeared, just as many animals also disappeared. So our species was not the chosen one. It simply had the foresight to get rid of all competition, perhaps through violence, but perhaps also through our lack of specialization, which made us freer to adapt to different situations and climates. Ultimately, the spark of intellectual superiority should not be considered exclusive to the sapiens species, but instinctively to the whole genus Homo, a genus of which, as of 30,000 years ago, we remained the only representatives. And with that, we could also say that we have pinpointed the moment when the miracle happened, which was about 1 million years ago, when the scattered representatives of the genus Homo, already possessing all the necessary traits to begin to dominate the world, rudiments of language included, began to migrate to different parts of the world and to specialize in the way we know. And if we really had to venture an opinion on which of the evolutionary traits weighed most heavily on the scales of our transformation from hominids to humans, well, we would have to bet on the acquisition of articulate language. Yes, it is true, every animal has its own kind of language. All insects, such as bees and ants, know how to communicate with each other, and they do so in sophisticated ways, informing each other of places where food can be found. Baboons use calls of various kinds to describe what kind of danger is about to reach the herd. Whales and elephants possess equally impressive communication skills. A parrot can say all the things Albert Einstein can say, and even mimic the sounds of a ringing telephone, a slamming door, or the howl of sirens. Yet parrots will never be able to set foot on the moon. What then is so special about our language? The most common answer is that our language is extraordinarily pliable. We can connect a limited number of sounds and signals to produce an infinite number of sentences, each having a distinct meaning. Thus, we can interject, store, and communicate a prodigious amount of information about the world around us. Ultimately, albeit grudgingly, we answered the initial question. It all began in Africa 1 million years ago, when a biped capable of making tools began hunting in groups, developing a primitive form of language. Then there was diaspora to the rest of the world, and speciation in accordance with the climates and environments to be faced. And then, of all those intelligent species, only one remained: ours.